And there was a reason for picking up this topic. One, some of you have already heard at least some part of the Mahavakya Vichara from me in the classes. Anyone who has done Vedanta Sara from me has heard that. There's some who have not. So I'll follow the classical method once here, like how you followed in Vedanta Sara. A day, maybe two. Then also show why that method evolved like that. By referring to the source books, I'll show you why it has come, how it has come. So, there are a lot of, I know many of you read books here and there or attend lectures here and there. And the popular notion is there are only four Mahavakyas. Some people also present it as Upanishadic mantras for chanting. There's none of those things. There's not four. You have those sheets here? Okay. You want to distribute it now or? It is not limited to four. There are hundreds. What is a Mahavakya? In a way, before I give you the definition, all of Vedanta can be reduced to that one sentence. If you want to say, what is Vedanta? One sentence. Aham Brahmasmi. Tattvamasi. Satyam Jnanam Anantam. That's it. Everything else in Vedanta used to make you understand this Vakya. Therefore, Mahavakya is Vedanta actually. Every Upanishad has it. In some form or the other. The Gita has it in a different form. Why? Because if it is not there, if statements like that are not there, you don't understand the truth. You don't understand yourself. Though, there are certain 3, 4, 5 we are taken for classical analysis because they form the structure very nicely. And Shankaracharya's analysis took 4, one from each Veda. So people started thinking that there are only 4 Mahavakyas. A simple definition of the Mahavakya would be Akhandartha Bodhakam Vakyam. A sentence that will give you the knowledge, Bodhakam, that will give you the knowledge of Akhandam Artham, the indivisible whole, to put it into a closest possible translation. Indivisible whole. Akhanda Bodha. Akhanda Artha Bodhakam Vakyam Mahavakyam. In fact, a sentence that reveals you are everything that you seek. You are the whole. That is a Mahavakya. Because, and generally the Upanishad Vakyas are taken as a Mahavakya because the Upanishad is a pramana for knowing the truth. To quickly summarize, okay, we have seen the Pancha Pramanas that we all have, that we all use for every knowledge we gain in the world. From making a cup of tea to landing a person on the moon or Mars, these 5 pramanas are used. Perception, 5-fold, your sense organs. That is a basic pramana. Everything else is based on that. Your perceptual data. In English, this is the closest that you will come to saying fact. Then Vedanta will question that also. When you say something is a fact, why? This is a file of paper. It's fact. Anything else you say about it will be your interpretation. Perception. So this is elaborate theory of perception, etc. Light is reflected to the eyes, etc. That's one photometry model. The photometry model is followed in science is what? The object reflects the light to my eyes, they see it. In dialectical Vedanta, we modify that slightly. Since the mind occupies the space of the object to see it. Because if the mind doesn't take the form of the object, inside or outside, doesn't matter, you will not see an object. The theory of light is enough to explain normal perception. The scientific model. And nor are you going to see anything without light. That also is clear. But the role of the mind is equally important, because if your mind is elsewhere, you can look at something and not see. You can be here, but your mind is elsewhere, you will not hear. So mind taking the form of the object and you objectifying it, both are necessary. Both are necessary for any perception. The theory of light will not explain how erroneous perception takes place. How do you mistake a rope for a snake? You won't explain that. Because artificial intelligence will not make that mistake. Oh, I made that mistake because there is not enough light. If there is a robot here with artificial intelligence, if this was a robot looking out at, seeing a rope but not enough light, therefore it is not clear, it will say insufficient light, insufficient light, insufficient light. It will not say snake. Why? There is no thought being formed there, snake thought is not being formed. But you are a human being. Therefore, what is formed in your mind is snake. What you are seeing is snake. So the role of the mind in human perception becomes important. Okay. Now I am not speaking like how that minister spoke about dismissing science and things like that. No, I am not saying that. I accept science for what it is valid. If there are any limitations of it, then he'll point it out and enhance it. That much is fine. And anyway, science is like that. It grows by discovering its own mistakes. That's how science has grown. Let us not dismiss science. At the same time, let not science replace everything else also. You have to have a perspective. Science is meant for certain things and that it does a good job. Fine. Your perception. Basic pramana. But a pramana implies a pramata, a knower. Why? Because if the pramata is not there, who is going to use the pramana to see the prameya, the object of knowledge? And the pramata must be established before the pramana. The knower I should be there before I use a pramana to see things. Therefore, aham sota siddham. From looking at the pramana itself, we get that. That I am self-evident. How do you know you exist? Swamiji, I exist because of my father-in-law. I am married, you know. That you are talking of how you are existing. That's okay, I can accept that. Hey, come on. One generation back, we used to say woman marries for money. So why can't men marry for money now? Come on, yaar. Equality, no? Right? We live in a world of equality. Therefore, if a woman can marry for money, a man can also marry for money. What's the problem? Can't have double standards. Okay. That apart. I exist is self-evident. If I exist was not self-evident, I will not be able to use any pramana, including perception. Which even a baby uses, a newborn baby also uses pramana, or perception. It will not be possible. If I is not Swata Siddham, established without the need of a Pramana. So now here I am the Pramana, Pramata, using all the Pramanas to figure out things. Perception basic. After that we did Anumanam, inference. Hear a sound and infer. Hey, that sound. What is that? Like Swamiji said, that's Ganesha declaring his presence there. Okay. You didn't see the elephant. You only heard the sound. But from the sound you inferred. Because Vyapti Jnanam was there. Wherever the sound is there, it is made by an elephant. And how did you get there? Vyapti Jnanam? Perception. Vyapti Jnanam is previous perception. Therefore, Anumanam. Arthapatti. Deductive logic is called Arthapatti. What goes in the Western philosophy is deductive logic. Arthapatti. Two-step, three-step, four-step inferences. In the previous camp I said that, I gave that example of this character going on a hunger strike and not losing weight. For those who are not there, I was a kid and this character is sitting on a hunger strike and he is full of energy, everything, whole day is not eating, you can see that. He was taking sips of water, that's all he was doing, nothing else. Then in the night people would leave. I mean, some supporters are always there when someone sits on a hunger strike. Night they all go to sleep at their home. This character is sitting under that tree there. They leave a flashlight for him. And go. Huge flashlight. Huh? Three cells. You see some people carrying it around here. The security has it. Huge one. And then when everyone is gone at about 10 o'clock in the night, you open the back side of the flashlight and pulls out a huge banana from Kerala. You've seen this Kerala banana? When you're coming from the airport to the station, you would have seen that huge one. You eat one of that, 24 hours you can sustain yourself. That's deductive logic. If you don't see it, it is what? He, since he doesn't eat during the day, and his energy levels, weight, etc. is normal, you make a presumption, a deductive logic, he must be eating in the night. That's called Arthapatti. Deductive logic. All your Sherlock Holmes stories are all based on deductive logic. Lot of science is deductive logic. When you go with a medical report to the doctor, it's all deductive logic. Oh, this protein is there. Anumanam, this problem is there. These things are not there. Therefore, this should be the issue. Deductive logic. Arthapatti. Upamanam, comparison. What is a water buffalo? You know. Sand, what do you call it in North India? Water buffalo. What have you seen in Bahubali movie? That's water buffalo. देखा क्या नहीं बाहुबली देखा है ना मस्त सीन दैट्स पॉपुलर इन द गेम ओके सो गेट फाइट्स दैट वाटर बफलो आई थिंक दिस गाय इज गोइंग टू स्टेट्स से ए गो एंड सी अ बाइसन इज अ यूनिक एनिमल दैट यू सी ओनली इन यूएसए व्हाट इज अ बाइसन समथिंग लाइक अ वाटर बफलो नोबडी हैज कम बैक एंड सेड इट इज नॉट लाइक अ इट इज नॉट अ वाटर बफलो ऑफ कोर्स इज नॉट अ वाटर बफलो. It is like similarity. I mean, there will be differences also. Otherwise, we would not call it a bison. We will call it water buffalo. Upama. By the knowledge of similars you get. Again, lot of scientific development has been on the basis of similars. How will a South Indian explain what an avial is to someone from UP? Upamana you let to use, there's nothing other way.
Yeah, comparative knowledge.
No other way, no?
No other way.
So you use all these pramanas in your daily life. A child, your child will come and ask, Daddy, what is marriage? What do you tell? You'll have to use a lot of upamana, okay?
Yeah, only then you can explain something to the child
without telling too much, at the same time telling enough.
All that is based on upamana.
It's not that you come to Vedanta and suddenly you realize there are five pramanas. You've been using it all the time, ever since you were a kid. By the time you're 5 years old, you have learned to use all these pramanas. Then after that, got refined. Those who studied logic, refined it further. Refined it further. Those who didn't study logic, picked up a lot of distortions in their pramanas. That's what happens. None of them is meant for knowing yourself. Why? Pramata self-established rumor. He is using all these five pramanas. Therefore, for knowing those things that these five cannot deliver, you have the Veda as the sixth pramana. A lot of it in the Veda is called Paroksha Jnanam or belief. Paroksha Jnanam is supposed to be indirect knowledge. Some of them are as good as beliefs only. Only we don't call it belief because when you say belief, there's a possibility it is not true. Is there heaven? I believe so. That means it may be true, it may not be true. To avoid that, the Veda Pramana we'll call gives you indirect knowledge, Paroksha Jnana. There is heaven. Heaven is like this. There's an Indra ruling there. Sometimes he is as problematic as the local Indra we had. Most of the time he is benign. There is a description. If you take it as belief, you are granting yourself the possibility that heaven doesn't exist. To prevent that, we say Paroksha Jnanam, indirect knowledge. Well, it is there, but I don't know about it now. If both of us die and go to the same place together, I can tell you. Haan, dekha, bola tha na, aisa hai. Dekha, welcome drink, soma juice hai. You can say that. Anyway, I'm not going to come there, and I hope none of you have to go there also. Well, it is there, but right now I am not capable of seeing it. Similarly, previous lifetime, future birth, all that is Paroksha Jnana, based on the Veda. No, no, Swamiji, your past life regression, I saw my life happen. Yeah, yeah, I also do it. And I know what is happening in this past life regression. It's all accessing your deep-seated subconscious, unconscious memories, that's all. So you can never be sure whether that really was a past life or it was some book that you read 15 years ago and you have forgotten it. You don't never know for sure. Past life regression does not establish past life. The Veda establishes it, past life regression supports it. That's how it is. How do you know? Because I do it. I know. This is how it is. Veda is a pramana. Swamiji is a baat bat ho gaya. I've been there, done that, seen a lot of things. Now I want to have fulfillment in life. My life is always, I feel incomplete. I mean, my life is fine that way if you look at it. Great house, great wife, great kids, everything is fine. Really? There is one place on earth where all husbands are loving and kind, all children are very good and obedient, your job is great, house is great, life is perfect. You know what that place, that place called? Facebook. Yeah. Everything is perfect. But everything is fine in your life. But still something is lacking. I don't feel complete. There's something missing. Therefore, I've been trying to make that thing complete by travel, by this, by that. By what they call in this area, having a small house also. Other than the big house. Okay, but it's all that. Life is not complete. Therefore, some amount of examining of life has been done by you. Because with all your experiences undergone, hopefully you have learned something from it. So we say pariksha loka, having examined life. Nirveda maya brahmana. For this thinker, brahmana here, let us take it as sattva guna pradana. Predominantly sattvic person, a thinker, an intellectual. That person, nirveda mayat, he gains a certain sense of objectivity in life. I mean, it's nice. I got emotional and physical companionship. But more than that, what is there in a marriage? Money gives me the convenience to do things for myself, for others, everything. More than that, what can it do? So you get a certain sense of objectivity. And you understand, nasti akritaha kritena, that what I am seeking, that fullness and completeness, I am not going to get it by action, because the result of every action is finite. Therefore, I am going to get only finite things. And finite things are not satisfying me. I have a lot of finite things. Been there, done that, achieved a lot. Made money, gave away money, sab kuch kiya. Now what? Sometimes gave away money under pressure. Why? You came together and then you separated out. So there is pressure to give away that money. But still you gave away. You thought your freedom was worth it. Yeah. Freedom is worth it. Okay? Parikshalokan. All that comes under Parikshalokan, okay? It's not that Parikshalokan only all the nice experiences, all the positive things you have. Every mistake you have committed is better Parikshalokan actually. Why do you think I came to Vedanta first? Lot of mistakes. Tasmas vijnanartham, to know that. Suddenly, from doing it is shifting to knowing. Why? If what you are seeking is the infinite, then finite won't deliver. You need the infinite. And the infinite cannot be separate from you. It is the most inclusive thing in the world. We talking of inclusive culture, excluding culture, etc. We are talking of the most inclusive thing in the universe, yourself. Therefore, he says, Vijnanartham, Guru Meva Abhigache. He goes to the Guru. Why? Because he has heard. Born in this culture, the person has heard. To know yourself for moksha, yeah. To get rid of this feeling of finitude, to get rid of this feeling of incompleteness. You need a guru. You know, one of my students, she did her master's in philosophy, Indian philosophy. Then she went to her teacher and said, I want to do my doctorate. And that lady, her teacher, turned around and asked her, why do you want to do a doctorate? So I want to know the truth. says, if you want to know the truth, find a guru. That academic professor said that. Find a guru. If you want to get a doctorate and have academic openings, then do it. It's worth it. But if you want to know the truth, go find a guru, is it? Then she went guru hunting. And then walked into one of my workshops and came. Guru Meva Vikachet, because the sixth pramana, called the Shabda, the Upanishad, has to be handled by a person. Why? Because we are talking about what? The infinite. And what are words? Each have finite meanings. Each word will have a finite meaning. The word infinite, what do you understand by the word infinite? It is not finite. Like incomplete, it is not complete. Complete? Okay. The work is complete. Okay. Oh, this is incomplete. Meaning? Not complete. So, finite? Infinite. In is used in the sense of un in Sanskrit. Okay. Not complete. That's all. So, that's all you understand. And you have only finite words with finite meanings to reveal that. Therefore, there's a certain methodology about it. That methodology is as sacred as a pramana. And this methodology will have a few paradigms to it. Each Upanishad is a paradigm. All having the same methodology. That's the beauty of it. Methodology is one, but the paradigms are many. There's a certain beauty about the whole thing. You know? That's why I said we'll look at it a bit holistically. Like some of my students, what would be the, for example, the paradigm in the Mandukya Karika, the Upanishad? The three states of experience, correct? Analysis of three states and who's the one behind the whole thing. That's a different paradigm. In Keno Upanishad, who's a thinker, knower, etc. Yeah. Can you see? But all of them will have one thing in common. That is called Adhyaropa Apavada Nyaya. The logic, the methodology of Adhyaropa Apavada. Adhyaropa is whatever is superimposed. In the famous examples, the snake is superimposed on the rope. So you have to negate Adhyaropasya Apavada. You have to negate that. Because if both of us are walking on the road, you are seeing a snake and I am seeing the rope. And you say snake. Hey, snake. I say rope. Snake. Rope. Swamiji, there is a snake there, be careful. Rope. What will you tell me? I know what my students will. Because I am very informal with them. Go hang yourself with that rope, there's a snake here. Right or wrong? Hey, it is not a snake. What you see as a snake is actually a rope. I have to say it like that. Adhyaropa se apavada. If I don't negate the snake and just say rope, 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 we are cross communication. We are communicating at cross purposes. There is no communication happening. Therefore, that has to be common in all styles of teaching. Therefore, that is a fundamental methodology. Adhyaropa Apavada. Without that, you can't teach. Then the truth has to be pointed out. That's also important. If I say it is not a snake, okay, what is it then? Yeah, something else it is. You can still make another mistake, no? So this negating your superimpositions and presenting the truth. Sometimes it will involve clubbing all your superimpositions into one and then negating it. It will also, sometimes it may involve explaining why you got that superimposition. Okay. okay, you saw the rope. Then you are asking me, if it was a rope, why did I see the snake? If you ask me that, what should I tell you? I don't know. Why did you see it?
I'm saying rope.
Or supposing the question is slightly different. Where did the snake go? People ask these questions, you know. Then what? So the teaching tradition will also handle these things. It's quite a vast system. It'll also help the student to get ready for learning, for understanding, because it requires a very different mind, no? A mind that can drop certain things it has been holding on to out of fear, out of love, whatever. Where did you see the snake? I love snakes. I'm from Mallu land. I'm from Kerala, just across the border here. And we love snakes, you know. In all our homes there are sarpakav, you know, a small temple for snakes. And we worship snakes. Every day a lamp is lit. So, yeah, we love snakes. So I saw this. Or, oh my God, I'm very scared of snakes. That's right. Out of fear you saw, out of love you saw. I'm very curious about them, I study them, you know. Out of that you saw. I never seen a snake in my life, but I read Harry Potter. Because of that I'm interested in snakes.
Okay.
Because of that you saw. You can have 100 psychological reasons. And all of them can make you hold on to that snake. Which is not there really speaking. Which is something else. Therefore the mind has to be a mind that can drop it. And refocus on the truth. But Swamiji, I'm quite okay. I'm quite a good focus, you know. Then I'll tell you like that karate kid. Your focus requires some more focus. And we will help you get that focus also. In our 11 o'clock sessions. Yes, your focus requires more. That's part of the teaching. That's all part of the teaching. The Uttamadhikaris don't require all that. They come only for the knowledge, fine. But we all don't go as Uttamadhikaris. Outside the pages of the Upanishads and the Gita, where is an Uttamadhikari? Not there. Yeah. We all require some help and other things for that. So all this is part. Therefore, you need a person there who handles that tradition of teaching, the sampradaya of teaching. Therefore, Guru Meva Vivachit. And whatever he teaches, the whole teaching is summed up in one sentence. That's called the Mahavakya. The whole teaching centers around this. The Mahavakya is a teaching. Therefore, that's why when you do an archana for Puja Swamiji or Dakshinamurti or something, you'll always find this word there. Mahavakya Upadesha Kartrave Namaha. So the one who is doing the Mahavakya Upadesha, to that person my prostrations. Every teacher is that. Okay? If he cannot do that, he is not a teacher. Anyway, all that is old, I teach something new of my own. That may be interesting. But whether it will deliver moksha or not, it's not a question. There are quite a few Mallus here. Quite a few Mallus are here, yeah. I know. Who's Ayyappa? What do you find outside Ayyappa temple written? Tattvamasi is a Mahavakya. He is supposed to be Mahavakya Upadesha Karta. Ayyappa is supposed to be a teacher actually. And the whole Ayyappa worship, going to Ayyappa, Sabarimala, is all representative of the sannyasa tradition. And you are going there for
moksha.
Mahavakya Upadesha.
They say if you go there, you will get moksha.
Swami Akandal Mokshan Gittam. What is moksha? Because he is Upadesha. Therefore, even though he is a warrior, he is a guru. Okay. So, who said warriors can't be guru? In our tradition, we had butchers as also gurus. What your life is, it doesn't matter. If you know and you can teach the Mahavakya, you are a guru of it. Then what is the Mahavakya? What is representative analysis, etc. We will see in the next class. Okay. Now, Swamini is going to take the class. Okay. It will be on the Upadesha Asana. In the recording, can you break it up or we will break it up later? Break it up later?
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. You can then continue straight and we will do the. If you want a 5-minute break, bathroom break, this, that, etc., please take that.